Hey everybody, I'm JimClassic and you are watching Geekin It. And here we have the original Mighty Morphin Power Rangers team. Red, yellow, blue, black, green, and white. That's right, Tommy Oliver is being represented twice here. Now, what I'm going to do to avoid this video being like 2 hours long, I'm only going to really review two figures. One male, one female, because they are obviously two different molds. And anything that might be different, I will address. But I will not be going over the full articulation and range of every figure because it's pretty much going to be identical for the most part. Since this is the Mighty Morphin Power Ranger team, we'll start with Jason, the Red Leader. Jason has the male masculine body type. Starting with the head sculpt, we see the Tyrannosaurus helmet that he did sport in the show. It's got some good sculpting detail with the eyes and the head crest and the sweeping lines, and it's got some nice paint apps. The black visor and silver mouth are also good. And however, the head sculpt might be a little disproportionate to the human body. Helmets are supposed to be a little bit larger than the human head itself, and this looks like it's the exact size of the human head, and that does kind of bug me a little bit. This would indicate that Jason and all the other Power Rangers have all pinheads underneath these, and you know, I'm not gonna lie, that is just a little bit off-putting for me. Now, for the rest of the figure, we have the traditional white and parentheses, insert color palette here, diamond pattern, which is pretty cool. And overall, you know, it's pretty much just red plastic with the white paint apps for the most part. However, indicated where the hands are all white plastic, but the arms where the gloves, I think that's red plastic with white paint. We have the belt, which is a, you know, red plastic, white paint. And we also have the morpher, which is nicely detailed. Has the black, you know, around the belt area, the silver for the morpher, the gold power coin, and you can even see a little bit of the Tyrannosaurus power coin on the morpher, which is kind of cool. So, let's just move on to articulation. The head is on a ball joint. It can, you know, go 180 degrees. There's also a hinge at the base of the ball joint, so it allows him to do some really good range of motion. He can look up. He can look very far down into his chest. So this is some good head rotation there, head movement in general. We have an ab crunch, which allows him to really lean over forward, or he can arch his back all the way. Again, really nice. And even the white diamond on the chest at least follows form when he leans back. When he crunches forward, you know, it kind of disappears a little bit, but, you know, you can just assume that's the folds of the fabric, so, you know, whatever. We do have some good shoulders here. We do have what looks like some padded shoulders here, which is not what the original Power Rangers had, but I believe it adds a nice little sculpting element to the figure. It is pretty much a universal hinge. We have, you know, you can just rotate the shoulders all day long if you really want to. We have a good bicep swivel. We have a double elbow, which allows a decent elbow curl. Let's see, we even have a forearm swivel at the glove. Oh, at the glove. So the glove is a completely different piece from the rest of the arm. I forgot about that. So that means that the glove is white plastic with red paint. I'm just sharing that with you. Anyway, so rotation of the glove. And we have a universal joint at the wrist. It can swivel every way. It can do all sorts of things. You can do all sorts of things with that hand. Okay, that's all I'm saying. We covered the ab crunch. We do have a waist swivel. It is limited. You can only swivel that waist so far. But still, it's not bad. And here we have, I believe the hips are ball jointed. It can go, he can do a nice little soccer kick. He's got decent, leg extension going forward. Decent going back a ways. I mean, you can at least make him in a running pose, which is fine. We have a double knee, which allows a really great knee bend, which is fantastic. Do we have... Oh, I forgot the thigh swivel. We do have a thigh swivel. We got that. And we do have, a universal... We have an ankle pivot. We have a toe... Not a toe. A heel... a bend at the ankle. Universal joint at the ankle, pretty much. You can tilt it forward. You can tilt it back. You can do a nice point. And you can do an ankle tilt. So, you can break his ankle all the way if you really want to. If you're just that freaking sadistic. So there's, this ranger has a great range of motion here. Now, each ranger comes with three accessories. Their sidearm, the holster for the sidearm, and a Megazord piece. Because for every Power Ranger in the Legacy Collection, they went in kind of a Build-A-Zord theme. So once you collected each of the Rangers, you'd be able to assemble the Megazord for that team. We'll dive into my thoughts on that later. However, I'm not a fan of the sidearm. I know all of the core Rangers come with one. It was rarely used in the show, and Bandai didn't include any of the Rangers' melee weapons, which we'll get into that later as well. All in all, the Red Ranger stands proud. Proud and strong, as any leader should. So, that being said, let's move on to the Black Ranger. The Black Ranger. Literally everything with the body is the exact same. Ab crunch, shoulders, double elbow, double knee, waist, etc., etc., etc. So, what are the differences? Well, there are two differences. The helmet and the morpher. So, looking at the helmet, I gotta say, the Black Ranger probably has my second favorite Power Rangers helmet. It just looks awesome. First off, it's nicely painted black. It's got some really striking gold eyes. We have some nice white outlines that would indicate the trunk and the lines around the visor. We have the silver mouth, and of course, we have the silver tusks lining the sides of the visor. It's really cool design. Oh, we have the little ears that kind of stick out in the back of the helmet, I guess, too. But it's just definitely one of the more interesting Power Rangers helmets. The Green Ranger being my favorite, of course. But I gotta give it to the Black Ranger, man. He got a cool frickin' helmet design. So anyway, let's just move on to the Morpher. Again, the plastic, the paint apps on the Morpher are nice. Black, silver, we have gold, and we got a nice little... engraved mammoth on the power coin. And that is awesome. Again, we come with the gun, the holster, and a Megazord piece, which I believe with the Black Ranger, it was one of the Megazord's arms. So, that pretty much covers the Black Ranger. Let's move on to the blue. Moving on to the Blue Ranger. We have, again, same body type, same... everything below the neck, pretty much. And but let's focus on the helmet. It's blue plastic. We have the nice Triceratops design. We have the three silver horns, the two directly above the gold eyes, one, the center horn at the forehead. Below that, we have a nice white outline above the black visor of the helmet, silver mouth. And it's not bad. It's a serviceable sculpt. It looks good. Again, we're dealing with a helmet, which is just a little bit too small for my comfort. It's going to be the same for all of them, but, just pointing it out again. And it's not a bad helmet. I mean, I'm not going to lie. The Blue Ranger is not my favorite Ranger at all. I find him the least interesting. And the helmet is one of those things I just find the least interesting. So let's move on to the Morpher. Again, the paint looks really nice on the Morpher. It's nice silver paint. There's red on the Morphers as well around the coin. And at the coin itself, we get the Triceratops power coin. Nice little engravement. I don't know what the word is I'm looking for. But it's not bad, you know. For something as small as these belt buckle power coins are, it's decent, you know. It's pretty darn good. Now, we'll get to the Sixth Rangers later. For right now, that's it for the boys in the core line. Let's just see how the ladies are doing, shall we? Starting with the Pink Ranger, Kimberly. So, looking at Kimberly, definitely not a male body sculpt. So, start, like we always do, with the head sculpt. We have the Pterodactyl Power Rangers helmet. Now, where most of the Power Rangers tend to have a solid color on their helmet, Pink Rangers is pink and white. I think, I'm pretty sure it is white plastic with pink paint. So, the pink paint is nicely applied. It just kind of sweeps around, around the eyes, around the back of the head, and maybe up the forehead. It's a nice, swooping, smooth sculpt. We have the pterodactyl head that goes from the top of the head down to the middle where the bridge of the nose would be. Nice black round visor, silver mouth, and that's it. It's just a simple, it's kind of like an elegant head sculpt. Again, I would say the helmet might be a little bit too small for the body, but, you know, it is what it is. So let's check out articulation. So, articulation, the head is on a ball joint. The head can look up that far. It can look down that far, which is pretty good. So it's on a hinge. We have an ab crunch. Well, it's kind of like an ab crunch. This is not a hinge. This is a ball joint. This is a ball joint where the male rangers had a hinge which could only swivel forward, not swivel, rotate. That's not the word either. Hinge. I'm going to say hinge. It could hinge forward or backwards. On the female sculpt, we can arch her back, we can ab crunch her forward, we can move her upper body side to side, which is different from the male body. So, you know, she can really work it. Moving on to the shoulders, we have universal shoulders, we have bicep swivel, we have, no double elbow. So that's a little disappointing. Where the men have a double elbow, the ladies do not. That is disappointing. We do have, a glove swivel. The glove does swivel. And we have a nice universal wrist. The wrist swivels, it hinges, it does everything you need it to do for posing. So, we already did the upper body torso, but there is a waist rotation as well. Again, much like the man, it's a limited waist rotation. So, I would dare say Pink Ranger here does have a little bit more body movement than the guys do. All right, so where the boys have a double elbow, the ladies have a little bit more of a body rotation going on, especially with that ball joint in the chest and the bust area. So moving down, we have now with the Pink Ranger. You know, starting from the belt and the Morpher, we have a skirt. The skirt is a soft, pliable plastic. It's not that pliable, really. It's actually a firm plastic. It's a pretty firm plastic up to the point where you really can't move her legs all that much. You can't really do much with that skirt. I mean, she can kind of, you know, split her legs apart a little bit for a wide stance, and she stands okay. But she really can't move her leg forward all that much or move her leg back all that much. Hips are on a ball joint. We do have a thigh rotation. At the very least, Pink Ranger does have a double knee. And the same thing with the foot. We do have a nice foot tilt. We can point. We can bend it forward. We can do an ankle swivel. And I almost forgot the boot rotation. The boot rotates as well. So that's pretty fancy stuff. Now, I will say, Pink Ranger's left foot is a bit weak. She does have stability issues, unfortunately. It's not the fact that she's a smaller toy. It's a weak knee. Now, she can stand okay, but, sometimes the table moves, and next thing you know, she's on the floor. Now, same thing with all, just like the boys, Pink Ranger does come with a gun, a holster, and a Megazord piece. Oh, and the Morpher. Almost forgot about the Morpher. Morpher, nice black with the silver, with the red, and the gold. And you see the pterodactyl coin in the center, which is really nice. Really nice. Really nice figure. And last but not least, we have Trini, the Yellow Ranger. Now, again, like Kimberly, she follows the female sculpt. Now, there are three differences from Trini. That is the helmet, the morpher, and the lack of a skirt. So, let's start with where we always start, the helmet. I actually really like the saber-tooth tiger helmet as well. This is a pretty cool helmet. Nice yellow plastic, beady black eyes, silver nose, the red visor with the silver saber-tooth teeth coming down the visor. That probably would get in the way of her vision, to be perfectly honest. And then the silver mouth. And otherwise, the joints are the same. Head rotation, upper body rotation, shoulders, waist. So let's move to the morpher. Again, nice painted plastic, nice gold plastic, nice silver plastic, and you see the saber-tooth tiger coin in the center. Now, again, big difference. That's not a big difference, but the Yellow Ranger does not have a skirt. That's it for the Yellow Ranger. Again, otherwise it's the same thing. She does not have stability issues, unlike Pink Ranger, so that's always good. And she can stand well. For the most part, all these Rangers do stand well. Other than Kimberly having difficulty standing, these rainbow-colored superheroes are all pretty rad, to be honest. However, we still have the Green and White Rangers, respectively, to contend with. Now, again, we're dealing with the male figure. And it's all pretty much copy and paste right there. However, along with the different helmets and the power morphers, both the Green and White Rangers have body armor. And that's the big difference. So, let's have a look. Starting with the Green Ranger, we have a really cool Green Ranger helmet. Now, again, I'm a fan of the Green Ranger. He's my favorite guy. I think I've mentioned that about a half a dozen times already. We have green plastic. We have the nice Dragon Zord mold with the fin on the top and the gold diamond in the center, beady black eyes. We have the molded dragon teeth around the black visor, and the teeth are in white. So it's a nice white rim with black visor, silver mouth. And that's it for the helmet. Range of articulation is exactly the same. Double elbow, universal hinge, ab crunch, all that stuff. Now, the big difference is, though, there is some mold difference. Some mold differences with the upper arms and the body. So, obviously, we have that big gold dragon armored crest that the Green Ranger is wearing. Now, it looks like it's part of the figure. It's like it's inserted into the torso area. So this is a permanent fixture. It's not coming off. I'm not planning on doing any damage to it, so it's not going anywhere. But it's a nicely gold-colored plastic with some black trim around the diamond. I love the molding. I love the shimmer of it. It's a nice color. It's a nice color. It looks like it's a nice, you know, metallic-y, plastic-y, goldy thingy, or whatever the hell it is I'm trying to say. Now, looking underneath the armpit of the armor, we have a gold strap that goes under the armpit. It's supposed to connect to both ends of the armor. Now, this is not part of the standard male mold. At least I don't think it is. No, it is not. It is not part of the standard mold. So the part of the upper body torso was remolded a little bit to give the illusion of the strap, which is cool. Looking at the biceps, you see Green Ranger has these gold bicep straps. They are also molded into the plastic. This is a new mold added to the figure. And I would say last but not least, the gold trim around the gloves. I think that is not new. The other Power Rangers have a trim around their gloves. It's just not painted. Moving down to the waist, we see the Green Ranger's morpher. Instead of a silver morpher like the others, we have a gold morpher with a gold power coin. You see that Green Ranger crest right there, bright and bold and wonderful. And the only other real difference with the Green Ranger here is the gold trim around the boots. Everything else is standard for the male figure. Now, Green Ranger does have a second pair of hands. I don't know where I put them, so I can't really show them to you. But he does have a separate pair of hands. They pop off on the wrist. They pop back on. And he also comes with a sheath and the Dragon Dagger. And I love the Dragon Dagger. It's beautiful. It's lovely. It's got all the colors. It's got the silver. It's got the gold. It's got the nice black. A little bit of green, I think. And for something as tiny as that, it is well sculpted, it looks nice, and the Green Ranger holds it well in his hands. Green Ranger also, as well as the Dragon Dagger and Sheath, Green Ranger also comes with his Sword of Evil that it is what he was first introduced with when Rita Repulsa captured him, made him the Green Ranger, and she gave him this sword. The sword itself is really nice. It looks like black plastic with silver paint. And the silver, again, is really nice, very shiny paint. It has the red jewel, which is semi-glossy, and then a firm, decent handle, unpainted plastic with a decent grip that the toy can hold. The sword's plastic is a bit pliable, so it's not something I would really monkey around with too often. That's it for the Green Ranger. Let's move on to the White Ranger, who is also Tommy Oliver. So, moving on. The White Ranger. We have a nice white plastic helmet with gold, silver, and black paint. And I gotta say that the White Ranger's got a pretty cool helmet. It's the most articulate design. Again, Green Ranger's still my favorite. But it's the Green Ranger's got the White Ranger's got a really cool design. Nice gold plastic, the black outlining some of the areas, black visor, the silver mouth with a hint of fangs on the sides of the mouth plate. It's a nice helmet, and the gold plastic is really good. Moving on to the male body again, you know, same articulation, same posability, same everything, but we do have that black and gold body armor. Now, I believe it is a gold plastic with black paint. And, yeah, it's not bad. It's just not bad. You know, the black is very glossy, and the gold is more of a matte color, really, which is kind of an interesting reverse. But yeah, glossy black and a matte gold. We have the White Ranger's crest on the chest plate, and it's molded well. It looks good. It looks really nice. Looking at the biceps, we do have that gold band around the bicep, And if you notice on the gauntlet, this is not a glove. It is a gauntlet now on the white Ranger. It's again the glossy black and the matte gold, and the molding looks good. It's really nice. It works. Looking at the belt, we have a completely different belt now, and it's White Ranger never really had his morpher on his belt. It's just like that Aztec looking box symbol. And it's molded okay. I've seen better molds on things that small, like, you know, the Rangers power coins definitely have nicer molding. So the White Ranger's belt is not as nicely molded. Moving down again, same articulation, ball jointed hips, thigh rotation, double knee. Moving down to the shins, again we have the same type of gauntlets. Or shin guards, or whatever. I don't even know what they're called. But anyway, the glossy black trim with the matte gold plastic, and it looks nice. And White Ranger comes with... I forget what he came with. He came with a sword. I know he came with a sword. I think he came with extra hands, too, but I probably lost those as well. But he also comes with Saba the Saber. A key element to the White Tiger Zord. And the White Ranger, his main accessory is the gold sword sheath. It's not even a sheath. It's just meant to hold the handle. But the sheath and Saba, you know, the saber. And Saba is, again, really nice sculpting. I really like this sword. It's white plastic. There's a lot of glossy silver paint, some glossy gold paint. Nice sculpting detail with the White Ranger's crest, and of course Saba's head at the hilt of the sword. I don't remember. Yeah, I think that's called the hilt. Nice curved handle. You see Saba's head at the very end of the sword. Nice sculpting. You see like these little beady red eyes, black and silver paint, and it just looks really, really nice for a figure. I mean, these are all 6-inch figures. But, you know, for a weapon of this size, they did do a great job with the sculpting detail. So, pause. So, that's it for the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. The original 6/7 Rangers. And they're all pretty awesome, actually. I mean, aside from Pink Ranger having stability issues, as I said, they're all really cool. They're all really awesome. I really dig them. I don't own too many Power Rangers toys, at least not compared to the amount of Transformers toys that I own. But I mean, it's fun to have the core cast. However, before moving on to the assembled Megazord, I have one last Ranger I would like to talk about. And that would be the Gold Ranger from Power Rangers Zeo. Now, Power Rangers Zeo was like the third or fourth season of Power Rangers or something, and I never really got into it. It was okay. I have no intention of getting the core Zeo Rangers. I just don't. But, you know, the Black Ranger, the Gold Ranger was really cool because... Well, I like the way he looks, I like his armor, and it's also, this is Jason. This is Jason returns as the 6th Ranger. You know, this is after he left after season 2 or 3, and, you know, he came back to reprise his career as a Ranger, at least for Power Rangers Zeo. So, let's do this. Again, we are dealing with the male body. All the articulation, all the posability options are the same for the body. So we have, for the helmet, black paint and gold, a matte gold. I don't even know what kind of gold color this is. This is not a shimmery gold plastic. This is a bargain basement gold plastic. And maybe this is how the Gold Ranger looked in the actual TV show. I don't really remember, but it's just kind of jarring that, you know, the core Mighty Morphin Power Rangers have this. Some of those Power Rangers have nice glossy gold plastic, and then we have the Gold Ranger, who doesn't really have a lot of gold on him. It's just kind of gold simulated color. Anyway, the Zeo helmet is meant to resemble the Zeo crystal. So his visor resembles the shape of the Zeo crystal. We have a sculpted mouth, and well, that's it for the Gold Ranger's helmet. Very basic molding. I mean, it's not bad. It's serviceable. It does its job, and, you know, there we have it. Now, there is a sculpted collar around Gold Ranger's neck. It has that Zeo Aztec sculpting, and it looks good, actually. It's got some fine detailing around it, and it's awesome. It's cool. It works. Moving to the body, we have a very elaborate breastplate. And again, it's that same boring gold simulated plastic. That's what I'm calling it. Gold simulite. That's what I'm going to call it. So that's kind of boring. The gold simulite is boring. But again, we got that nice Zeo. We have that nice Zeo Aztec design all around the trim of the armor. The sculpting is good. I really enjoy it. You know, we got the crossbar down there, and this is it's all one thing. It does split underneath the armpit, but that's fine. But it's this one big breastplate, and it just wraps around the body, and it doesn't affect the ab crunch too much, a little bit, but it doesn't really affect it, and it works. We have the bicep armor, very similar to the Green Rangers, but it is different. And on the gloves, we have the different type of gloves with the Aztec design around the top of the glove, and it works. For the belt, we have a basic belt, and we have the Zeo. We have the Zeo design on the belt. It's nicely molded. The molding is good. It's this gold simulite, which I'm not a fan of. So moving down, we have the same range of articulation, ball joint, thigh swivel, double knee, but it doesn't work because of the armor. Yeah, double knee doesn't really work because the Gold Ranger's armor on the boots does not allow it. But we have a piece of armor around the thigh. We have a nice kneecap right there, the Gold Ranger kneecap thing, and then the gold Aztec designs on the top of the boot. And I believe the feet might be slightly different. Boots might be slightly different. Gold Ranger, I believe, only came with his scepter, and the scepter is nice. It's the least favorite of all the Sixth Ranger devices, but that's okay. Very pliable black plastic. We have that gold simulite on both ends, but there is some nice shimmery silver paint on the spear end and on the Zeo-shaped end, and it looks like a little button. I guess that's to summon the Pyramidus Zord. It's got some nice sculpting. It's got great sculpting, as I said, with everything else. We got nice, grip for the hands. We have these nice little designs. And again, there's more Aztec designs around the spear end of the saber or the staff. And it looks good. I've never really understood what this weapon is. Like, you can't really do much with this. I mean, it's a mace, I guess. I guess he could just club his enemies over the head with it, but that's kind of it. And that's kind of it for the Gold Ranger. Okay, so let's get to comparisons. Since these are six figures, let's compare them to Rogue here from X-Men Legends and Gwenpool, because why the hell not? We got Jango Fett. Hey, there we go. It's a nice crossover thing going on. It's fantastic, right? So, I stated earlier I was going to return to the subject of the Power Rangers weapons. And where are they? Apparently, the OG 5 Power Rangers were repackaged minus the Megazord parts, given premium paint jobs, and Bandai included their weapons. You know, I would feel a little ripped off by this. Each one of these figures was about $20 each, give or take. So buying these 7 Rangers, it cost me around $130 total. I'm not doing that all over again just for the weapons and a glossy paint job. That should have been included with the regular sets of the figures. I mean, that this is an example of pure greed on Bandai's part, knowing they could exploit some collectors into repurchasing the original 5 Rangers. And you know what? I might be a sucker when it comes to some of my toy collecting, but that is a bit too much in my opinion, and I'm not touching them. So, we've talked about the Rangers. Let's move on and assemble that Megazord. First off, what a lanky brawler bot this thing is. I mean, the Megazord is supposed to stand at about a height of 41 meters. I'm pretty sure it's not supposed to be all legs. The proportions, they're supposed to be a bit more of a stocky build for the original Megazord. But, wowzers, I don't know. I'm just not a huge fan about just how thin and tall looking this version of it is. Moving on to the design, well, it's simplistic. I mean, everything is where it's supposed to be, and you can recognize what each piece is, but I think Bandai could have pushed the finer details a lot more, especially since we're looking at all this cool Aztec detail on the Gold Ranger, and some of the finer details on, like, the Dragon Dagger and Saba, you know, the saber. They could have added some extra detail to that Megazord to just make it look a little less basic. Let's move on to articulation! So looking at the Megazord here, we have a nice ball-jointed head, can be rotated all over the place. It can't really look up that far, and it can't really look down all that far, but it can kind of tilt its head a little bit, and you know, that's all that stuff. We have nice ball-jointed arms, or shoulders, I should say. It can go in and out a little bit. It can go, you know, it has a limited range because it is kind of a boxy-looking thing. But it does have some range. You know, the shoulder panels give it a little bit of limitations in some ways and a little leeway in others. But, you know, it's not bad. I've seen worse. I've seen much worse. No bicep rotation. That's not cool. We do have a bend of the elbow at almost 90 degrees. It's passable. And then we have a ball-jointed wrist. It's pretty much universal. It can go any which way. It's a nice semi-closed fist meant to hold something. We'll get to that later. No waist swivel. Yeah, no waist swivel. Okay. Ball-jointed hips. However, due to the hip skirts, which are a solid piece of plastic, it can't really go too far. It can't really, you know, it has a decent enough leg spread, but it can't really move the legs forward and backwards all that much. No thigh swivel. However, this ball-jointed hip does allow a great deal of rotation. We do have a ball joint at the knee, which will allow some swivel at the knee as well. But again, the ball joint is kind of loose around the knee. It doesn't allow for a good knee bend at all. It's constantly popping out if you bend it too far. Then all the way down here, we have a ball-jointed ankle, which is the foot of the foot of the saber-toothed tiger or triceratops, respectively. Ball-jointed ankle is great because it allows for, it definitely allows for a lot of, articulation in pose in the feet. However, I do feel it's a little bit loose sometimes, and it's not always the most stable thing. Though I will say this is a big, flat feet, which, if the ball joint was a little bit tighter, this thing could stand almost all the time and, probably survive, an earthquake or something. The articulation is... It has a variety of articulation, but not as good as the Rangers themselves. And what it does have is limited. Yeah, it's just a limited articulation. And it could have been better. It could have been a lot better. However, there is still one thing missing. As I said, the fist is semi... It's semi-closed. It's like it's kind of a fist, but it's also open to be able to hold something. Where is the broadsword? Where is the broadsword that the Megazord is supposed to come with? Seriously, a fight against one of Rita's monsters isn't over until the Rangers call upon the Megazord's power sword to finish it off. And this toy doesn't have one. It doesn't come with, this is a Build-A-Figure. You'd think one of the Rangers would have come with the sword. I don't like that. Not one bit. In spite of the fact that the Megazord does not come with his power sword, I actually have an alternative for him as a weapon. One of my friends was cleaning out her room and gave me some of her old toys. One of them being this old shitty plastic chromed katana. I don't even know what this toy is from, but it fits Megazord really well. Granted, Megazord is supposed to have a broadsword, but this katana will do. It works. It holds in his hand, and now I feel like he can go toe-to-toe with, somebody. Standing next to the Rangers here, just to get a perspective on the scale of the toy, he does stand a little bit taller than the Rangers, which that's okay, but really, the Megazord is the last resort for fighting giant monsters, and where are they? Oh, wait. There are no bad guys in the Power Rangers Legacy line. I wanted to see some enemies. I wanted to see some baddies. Like the Legacy Rangers released several Power Rangers from different eras mixed together in each wave. However, there were no bad guys. I would have really liked to have seen Goldar or Lord Zedd. And that really should have happened. The Power Rangers need the bad guys to fight. Otherwise, what's the point of collecting the heroes anyway? I mean, sure, I suppose my Legacy Power Rangers could team up with Rogue and battle Darth Vader. Why not? And at the very least, the Megazord can battle with, it can fight the Power Rangers Megaforce Armored Green Ranger from, a 2014 toy line, and that's kinda cool. And I got a Robotech mech from, my childhood. That thing kind of still holds up. I guess that could work. And then, of course, I have this green-white Tiger Zord. I don't even remember what this line was from. It's one of those, things where you could disassemble them and make other stuff. And, that was kind of interesting. Yeah, maybe also Darth Vader. But really, I think Bandai missed out on a couple of opportunities here, and not just with the lack of villains. Where the legacy Voltron figure had the five lions, and they had to all, and they could all form up to make the huge 16-inch Voltron figure, and yet Bandai hasn't really done that, or at the very least, not to the level of decent articulation. You know, they can do it, of course. They've done Power Rangers for 20, 30 years, but their Zords were always very stiff. You know, no real elbows, no real knees or waist articulation or anything like that, where the legendary Voltron had a lot of that stuff in spades. And I always imagined that Bandai should have and could have done that, and that was kind of a no-brainer. But now that Hasbro will be taking over the Power Rangers license, we'll just have to see what they do with the Zords and the Power Rangers as a whole. I'm Jim Classic, and you have been watching Geekin' It.